Let me bookend the greatest accomplishments in earthquake science during the last century. The first one began through the total destruction of San Francisco in the great 1906 earthquake. And after the city burned to the ground, geologists from Berkeley and Stanford started walking the path of destruction to the north and the south. And they found a tear, a rent in the landscape, which they soon traced out over 300 miles, 450 kilometers, and they christened it the San Andreas Fault. And further, they found that whenever the fault crossed a road or a line of fences, it offset those features, and in a peculiar way. No matter which side you were on, the other side had been shoved to the right. These two sets of yellow dots were formerly together. And they christened that right lateral fault slip. And then they brought the geodesists who made the Gold Rush shipping navigation maps back to San Francisco in the Bay Area to resurvey those monuments to figure out what was the broad pattern of deformation off the fault and not just on it. And what they discovered is, in addition to that 12 or 15 feet of offset along the fault, the farther you got away from the fault, the lower the displacements got, like the fault had leaped ahead. And then H.F. Reed said, let's go back and look at the measurements that were made from the time of the Gold Rush in 1849 up until before the earthquake. And he found something truly astonishing. The entire Bay Area had been locked into a giant shear vise. The earthquake wasn't the whole show. And what he realized was, if this had been going on, not just for 50 years, but for 250, if we add those displacements between earthquakes to what happened during the earthquake, we just get a simple offset. So the fault catches up when it's been strained for all this period. And what we end up with is a fault that has a long-term rate of displacement of an inch a year, 2.5 centimeters a year. Now, this was truly an astonishing discovery, because even if the Earth was only 10 million years old, which was believed at the time, it would mean that the San Andreas had to displace the Earth 150 miles, 250 kilometers, utterly incompatible with the fixed and rigid Earth as it was believed then. This was the irrefutable evidence that the Earth's crust had to be mobile, and this seed would germinate for 60 years until the revolution of plate tectonics arrived. But there's another legacy of the Lawson report, which is that if this shear indicates where future earthquakes could occur, what we should be doing is measure shearing all over the Earth. And today, with 30,000 continuous GPS instruments, we can actually see the shear associated with all of the faults, and so we know areas more likely to produce earthquakes. And there is the San Andreas system in the center. And now I want to take you to the upper corner in Alaska, where Alaska's San Andreas, the Denali Fault, crosses the planned route of the Trans-Alaska Pipeline that brings crude oil from Prudhoe Bay to Valdez. And the question was, what kind of displacement could that fault produce? And Lloyd Clough assembled a team of very young geologists who would all go on to brilliant careers to find the fault and to make that estimate. Here is the Denali in Alaska, right lateral just like the San Andreas. Here is the site where they discovered the greatest prehistoric slip in an earthquake, 38 feet. And at the site where the pipeline crosses the fault, here are their estimates of what the Alaska engineers needed to design for. Well, 30 years later, the magnitude 7.9 Denali earthquake struck, and here are its displacements. And not a drop of crude was released into that pristine Alaska wilderness. How did they do it? By building a telephone cord pipeline on Teflon skids. This is what happens when great science and engineering are joined, and this is why we are Earth scientists, to discover and protect.